Hey everyone, welcome to my video series on low-frequency RFID. InstaFob is available at Lowe's or Home Depot. They come blank, but the store reprograms them to be a copy of your existing fob. In this video, we're writing code to enable the Flipper Zero to detect a new InstaFob. We can reset any T5577 to behave like a blank InstaFob. Let's get started. In my previous video, we used the Proxmark 3 to dump the InstaFob's T5577 data. The configuration block is 880E8, which means our data rate is RF divided by 32. Our modulation is Manchester. We have 7 data blocks, and the sequence terminator is set. The first block of user data on both tags was 00107060. And the second block was all zeros on one insta tag, and it had data in the other insta tag. All the rest of the data blocks were zeros. Our Flipper Zero protocol encoder has 8 bytes of data. The first 4 bytes of data will always be 00107060. The second 4 bytes is whatever information we read from the card, which may be all zeros or it may have data. Also, since the first 4 bytes are always the same, we could have chose to not store it in the data array. If you haven't already set up your development environment, I'll put a link to how to set up your development environment. I've cloned official firmware, but you can clone whichever firmware you're using. Hopefully you've watched my previous video on LFRFID protocols, but if not, we're under lib, LFRFID, protocols. I've opened LFRFID protocols.h, and we've added an entry LFRFID protocol InstaFob. And then over in LFRFID protocols.c, we've added pound include protocol instafob.h. And then down in our LFRFID protocols array, we added an entry for InstaFob. And then in our protocol instafob.h file, we defined our protocol InstaFob variable. And then we implemented the protocol in protocol instafob.c. At the bottom of the file, we define our manufacturer as Hillman Group, and the name is InstaFob. Our data size is InstaFob decoded data size bytes, which is defined at the top of the file and equal to 8. We're using ASK, and we have to decode the same signal 3 times to consider it valid. Next, let's look at protocol InstaFob write data. This method writes data to any T5577 tag. We convert that data variable to a write request, and then we set result to false to indicate we haven't set the blocks yet. Next, we call protocol InstaFob encoder start. So jumping over to that method, we use bitlib getBits32, passing it our protocol data array, starting at bit 0 with a length of 32 bits. That'll give us back a 32-bit number. And if that number doesn't match InstaFob block 1, which is 00107060, we'll log an error, and then we'll use bitlib num to bytes BE to copy 4 bytes from InstaFob block 1 into the beginning of our protocol data array. Next, we use memset to clear out our encoded data array, and then we use bitlib copy bits to copy from protocol data starting from the 0th bit for our encoded size in bytes times 8 to convert it to bits. And we'll store that into encoded data starting at bit 0. These last 3 parameters are only used for the yield command, not the write command, so I'll cover them later. And then we return true. The top of our file has all those constants we've been using. Things like the decoded data size is 8 bytes. Our InstaFob block 1 is 107060, and our encoded data size bytes is 4 bytes times 7 blocks plus 1 byte for the sequence terminator. So back in our write data method, we check that our request write type is for a T5577. Currently, that's the only chipset Flipper supports. We set our block 0 to Manchester RF32 with the sequence terminator and 7 user data blocks. We use bitlib getbits32, starting at bit 0 for 32 bits to give us that 32-bit number for block 1. And then we use bitlib getbits32, starting at bit 32 to get the next 32 bits for block 2. And then for blocks 3 through 7, we set those to 0. And then we set our total blocks to write to 8 since we have that configuration block. We set result to true, and we log a debug message, and then we return the result. Next, we'll look at the code when we read a signal and when we get the details of that signal. That top row of hex is based on our data size variable, which is InstaFob decoded data size bytes, which we defined as 8 bytes that hold our block 1 and block 2 data. When we're encoding or decoding a tag, we have all 7 blocks, so 4 times 7, plus 1 byte for the sequence terminator. The sequence terminator is just a single bit, so our total number of bits is 8 times 4 times 7, plus 1 bit. And since our sequence terminator only takes a single bit, our offset is the remaining 7 bits. Low-frequency RFID is 125 kHz. We're using RF32. In Manchester encoded data, a 0 is a low followed by a high, and a 1 is a high followed by a low. So looking at the signal, we can see we have low-high, 0, low-high, 0, low-high, 0, high-low, 1, low-high, 0. When you have two highs next to each other, or two lows next to each other, they just look like a long signal. And our short signals are half that time. Our sequence terminator is a special signal, about 400 microseconds, and we allow the jitter to be plus or minus 40%. Our protocol InstaFob structure holds our 8 bytes of data with that block 1 and 2 information. And then we have the encoded data as we're encoding or decoding the signal. Encoded polarity is true when we've stored the first half of the signal, and false when we've stored the second half. The sequence terminator is set to the none state, except for when we're in the sequence terminator, and decoder Manchester state is used to help decode the Manchester signal. Our alloc allocates that protocol InstaFob structure, and then it sets the first 4 bytes of data to 00107060. Our protocol InstaFob getData method returns a pointer to our 8 bytes of data. Our protocol InstaFob renderBriefData returns fob followed by 2 32-bit numbers. Each number is shown as 8 nibbles. That first number, we start at bit 0 for 32 bits. And the second number, we start at bit 32 for 32 bits. Our protocol InstaFob renderData returns InstaFob and a new line, block 1 and a 32-bit number, and block 2 and a 32-bit number. And again, we read from bit 0 and then bit 32. When we're trying to read a tag, protocol InstaFob decoder start will get called. We set our data to all zeros, and we set our encoded data to all zeros. We reset our Manchester state machine. We set encoded polarity to false, so the next signal will be the beginning of a bit. And we set our sequence terminator state to none. Every time we receive a signal, our protocol InstaFob decoder feed method will get called, passing us the level and the duration in microseconds. We set decoded signal to false. And then we call protocol InstaFob Manchester event with our level and duration. We initialize the event to Manchester event reset for an unknown signal. If our duration is short plus or minus the jitter, we'll set the event to either Manchester event short high or Manchester event short low. If our duration is long plus or minus the jitter, we'll set the event to Manchester event long high or Manchester event long low. And then we'll return that short, long, or reset event. If we're processing our sequence terminator, or we got that reset event, we'll run the protocol InstaFob decoder sequence terminator. I'm going to skip over that code for now, but we can review it later. Next, we'll call Manchester Advance, passing it that event, and it will return to us a data bit and data OK if we should use that bit. So if our event was only for the first half of the bit, our data OK is false. And if the event covered the second half of the bit, then our data OK should be true. If data OK is true, we set encoded polarity to false, and then we use bitlib push bit to push our new data bit into the end of our encoded data array. This shifts all of our data one bit to the left. At the top of our program, if we define InstaFob check as we go, then we'll try to decode our data array. And if successful, we'll call InstaFob decode, set our decoded signal to true, and clear our encoded data. If Manchester advanced returned false, then we'll run our else block. And this code's a little strange. We check to see if our encoded polarity is true. And that means we're at the first half of our signal 2 times in a row. So our decoder must have been thinking that the first half was the second and the second half was the first. So we'll erase all of our currently encoded data and we'll push a 1 bit. Let me know in the comments if you have a better idea of how to deal with the decoder being out of phase. And then we set encoded polarity to true since we think we're at the first half of our signal. For most protocols, they'll do a check as we go, trying to decode the data every time they push a bit. For our protocol, we've chosen to implement the sequence terminator. So a sequence terminator, we're going to have a 1 bit get sent, and then a really long pulse, and then a short high and a long low. Our 1 bit will get decoded normally, but then our really long pulse will end up returning a Manchester event reset. In our protocol InstaFob decoder sequence terminator, we set decoded signal to false, and then we get the event again using protocol InstaFob Manchester event, passing that level and duration. If our level is high and the duration matches our sequence terminator duration, then we'll set our terminator state to state 3. State 1 and 2 were for the 1 bit that we've already decoded. Otherwise, if we're in state 3, if we received a short high, we'll move to state 4. Otherwise, we'll switch to state none. If we're in state 4 and we get the long low, then we'll move to state 6. When we're sending, state 5 is a short low and state 6 is a short low. So those two combine to be our long low, putting us in state 6. If we're in state 6, that means we're at the end of our sequence terminator. So we'll see if the protocol InstaFob can be decoded. If it can, we'll decode it, set the decoded signal to true, log our encoded data, clear our encoded data, and set encoded polarity to false to signal that we're at the second half of a signal. If it can't be decoded, we'll log a debug message with the data that we did decode. And then regardless if it was decoded or not, we'll clear our encoded terminate state. The last two functions to look at are the protocol InstaFob can be decoded and the protocol InstaFob decode. At this point, we've written those 7 blocks of data, but we've also read in that sequence terminator bit. This extra bit pushed our data 1 bit to the left, so it's no longer byte aligned. This means our data starts at the last bit of the first byte, so we need an offset of 7. We use bitlib getBits32, passing it our encoded data, that offset of 7, and request 32 bits of data. And we'll compare it with 107060, which is InstaFob block 1. For protocol InstaFob decode, we'll use bitlib copy bits to copy our encoded data starting at that offset 7 and copying 64 bits into our protocol data starting at bit 0. It's time to run our code, so we'll go to terminal, run task, and then we'll choose flash USB with resources. Make sure that Qflipper is not running and that you don't have any web updaters running. Hopefully you got firmware update success. If not, feel free to reach out in Discord. We'll go into RFID and then under extra actions, we'll do a read ASK. You can see that it now detects our InstaFob and shows us the fob information. And we can go to info to see the detailed information for that fob. Please like and subscribe and leave a comment below or in my Discord server.